Paris, Mecca of art and creative inspiration. The clothes, the sheen of the architecture, the craftsmen and women. Passion for beauty courses through the veins of the city. For many creatives, this place has been one of refuge and solace, as well as a breeding ground for greatness. It had become that place for Kanye West. He was on a mission to prove to the world that he was bigger than music. 5 beats a day for 3 summers turned into the soundtrack of a generation, and he was about to tell us that he was just getting started. When an artist climbs as high as Kanye, Michael Jackson, Prince, and Andre 3000, just to name a few, new horizons become more inviting than familiar success. Kanye had an on and off again working deal with Nike, bringing us the Yeezys, completing their collaboration with the release of the Red Octobers, the most coveted shoe of their time. But when he wanted to bring even more to the world after this success, suddenly, there were limits that the fashion and entertainment industries were trying to impose upon him.
What's going to happen with the Red Octobers?
You know what Nike told me when I asked them? We ain't sure. You know what they told the store, though? Okay. They said, if y'all want that Red October, you got to take these 10 other shoes. Mm-hmm. So they told me they ain't sure. But then they told them, if you want that Red October, but legally, we got to both sign that contract, Mark Parker. I'm going to put Mark Parker all on that Summer Jam screen. I got some more ideas that don't involve shoes.
Why don't you empower yourself and don't need them and do it yourself?
How, Sway?
If I've got ideas on color palettes, I've got ideas on silhouettes.
Bernard Arnault, head of Louis Vuitton, said he didn't understand why he needed to take a meeting with me.
And I've got a million people telling me why I can't do it. You know, that I'm not a real designer, I'm not this. I'm not a real rapper either. I'm not a real musician either.
You don't care about your designing sneakers and clothes and all that. That means nothing to us.
When I say Hedy Simane, I know y'all know who that is, but he sell in Phipps, Saint Laurent. He's the designer of Saint Laurent. He had his first fashion show, right? And I was always a fan of him. Man, he did a fashion show, and he tells me, you can come to my fashion show, but you can't go to Givenchy and you can't go to Celine. These are my friends also, Phoebe, Philo, and Ricardo. You tell me, wait a second, you just told Kanye West to not go to the Givenchy show? Meaning like I'm in Paris, I can't go to the Givenchy show?
The fact that the fashion designers won't accept you, Nike won't accept you, we don't care, we just want Ye to make great music.
You ain't got the answer, Sway.
Kanye.
I've been doing this more than you. You ain't spent $13 million of your own money trying to empower yourself. It's people that work in offices trying to tell me how to think when I got a better perspective. I live in Paris. You can't control me. So, you know, all corporations, radio stations, y'all can't control me. Y'all don't understand that. I'm turned all the way. Every time I talk, it is a crack in the matrix. You're not gonna tell me where I can go, where I can't go. It ain't that time.
At this point, Kanye felt restrained to his title of music artist. Well, if it was music they wanted, it was music he was going to give them. And it was going to be music unlike anything his audience had ever heard. He had worked so hard to win the public back with his previous critical darling, My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. But this time, he didn't feel like playing up to the expectations.
I showed people that I understand how to make perfect. Mm. You know, Dark Fantasy could be considered to be perfect, but that's not what I'm here to do. I'm here to crack the pavement and make new grounds, you know, sonically and in society, culturally.
So, his album was going to be the boldest, most jarring, most beautiful protest that Kanye West could offer. The storm needed to be perfect. And in order to reach that perfection, Kanye would need the strongest crew possible. Collaboration was going to be the lifeblood of the album-making process.
Like Mike Dean's over here, and you know, Noah's and Kielhoffer's and Plain Pat's and Cudi will come through, and you know, then that's when everybody comes through and he gets to telling them, you know, where he want to go with the album, what feel he want to have, and then people go in their rooms and, you know, come up with melodies on different beats that he selected, and that's how it all start coming together.
In the Yeezus sessions, Kanye worked with an all-star wrecking crew that had proved themselves in previous Kanye projects, including some new recruits.
And the combination of all the people we brought together from Daft Punk working on like 3-4 joints in the album, the first joint on site.
This is disgusting.
This is me going to the studio with Tomah and G-Man, who's Daft Punk, and they had a synthesizer like the size of that wall right there, and like, this is just one session right here. And this beat originally was like 14 minutes long. And that part in the beginning was something we completely just distorted it.
Yeah.
And I ended up making that the intro.
On site, you know, it was just like this.
Damn.
It was like this 30 minute long.
Craziness.
Like thing, you know, and like I just watched that album just evolve into like this whole like fresh thing, man.
I tell you what, they had a really good last name, Punk. Cause that's what I am till I die.
Yeezy season approaching. Fuck whatever y'all been hearing. Fuck whatever y'all been wearing. A monster about to come alive again.
Mike Dean.
Hey, what's up, Dolph? It's your Sluts.
You're a walking live instrument. When you play, you and Kanye do shows just you and Kanye.
His production, heavily augmented dark twisted fantasy, and his constant work alongside Ye makes him the yin to his yang.
Is there something that you love more than something else?
Playing guitar solos.
Okay.
Take a second and take me through in how you record guitars these days. And give me an example of a song that you like the sound of that process on that you did.
I like Hold My Liquor, the Kanye song, like guitarist. It's just playing through an intelligent harmonizer with auto-tune and guitar rig on it.
Justin Vernet of Bon Iver, having done exceptional vocal work on My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, was quick to answer Kanye's call to hit the studio. Justin trusted Kanye's musical decisions and worked extremely well under his direction.
Appear to be a, you know, he has this reputation of a megalomaniac, and you're probably the most modest guy we've ever had on the show. So it's like oil and water. Is he really like that way?
He's so open in the studio. He's so willing to, he's very encouraging, and he really like tries to get the best out of people. And I learned a lot from him, and watching him work and watching him not ever give up and making sure that every idea was the best idea. I am really thankful for all my time with him.
Then we have Noah Goldstein, Kanye's young lead engineer since Dark Fantasy and Watch the Throne.
We all work to the best of our ability and beyond sometimes, you know, or at least try to go beyond.
Sure.
And kind of come back together.
And I'd say, you know, we'll have conversations, not just about music life and what's going on in the world and everything, and that goes back into the music.
Another member was a producer named Evian Christ, who had a mixtape called Kings and Them, an industrial electronic project that Kanye had been playing during the Cruel Summer sessions. Kanye recruited him, and Christ pumped out 9 tracks specifically tailored to West. One of those tracks became I'm In It.
Travis Scott working on an album.
Yeah, man, you know, with Yeezus, man, like, I feel like that shit is like way ahead of what niggas thinking. Like, we was having this argument the other day. Me and Ye just bounce ideas. From there on, he just became like a big brother to me, man. Like, for real, like one of my biggest mentors, man. Like, it's crazy, like, the relationship. Like, this nigga's like kind of like a dad low-key.
Yeah.
I can kind of like call him for like anything. Usually, sometimes we don't even talk about music all the time. It just be just about life.
Yeah.
Guilt Trip is a song that producer S1 had cooked up during the Watch the Throne sessions.
I heard that joint for first time in Hawaii.
Get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, yeah. And like, I did the drums. Like, I redid the drums. S1 did the drums, the original drums in there. But like those new drums that's on there, I redid those and shit.
Oh, get the fuck out of here.
Yeah, so like,
at the end of the day, Yeezus really ended up becoming Kanye's least American album, drawing from the very heart of European electronic music. It looks to Europe for aesthetic guidance and fits Kanye's punk personality quite well. French techno artist Gelsaffelstein was making waves in the club scene. His hard-hitting club music was rousing and not just falling for typical Euro musical tropes. There was a heavy hip-hop influence in his production that really made him stand out.
I was not inspired by hip-hop when I was young. I just discovered hip-hop a few years ago with Bolinski because he's a huge fan of hip-hop and he plays hip-hop every time. And I was always like, please stop this music. And he always like, you have to listen to this music.
Kanye was determined to work with Gelsaffelstein in the studio. This specific song was the one that piqued Kanye's interest. The creative juices needed to flow organically. Kanye was looking for additional synthesizers to add to production already laid down by Daft Punk. Gelsaffelstein packed up his stuff and hit the studio and helped make Send It Up and Black Skinhead.
I'm assuming you and Brzezinski, or maybe you worked on that signature kind of electronic riff. I mean, that, you know, I mean, that is...
You're lost!
That is, you know, you want to smash stuff.
Fellow French DJ Brodinsky also worked with Gelsaffelstein.
For a guy like Brodinsky, he can see the connection between hip-hop and electronic music, and I saw the connection because I'm a big fan of early electro, like, and it sounds like hip-hop. It's the same 808.
Gelsaffelstein's album Aleph is clearly related to Yeezus, even down to the album cover. You can hear how his style infused Yeezus by listening to this album.
Hudson Mohawke, Arca.
Hudson Mohawke contributed to four tracks, with his most noticeable contribution being Blood on the Leaves.
We could have been somebody.
In an interview with Pitchfork, he notes that there were plenty of amazing, more melodic songs that could have been on Yeezus, but Kanye was committed to the stripped-down industrial tone that he had set from the beginning. No matter how amazing the songs were, he had a vision. Arca, in an interview with Vader, told this story regarding Kanye's creative workflow. He said that if Kanye wanted a song that was aggressive, he left it up to three or four people to design what in their head was the best solution for that aggression. And he notes that Kanye is still a true producer, but that his gift also lies in weaving the ideas that everyone brings to the table. Arca was credited for additional production, programming, and songwriting for five of the songs on Yeezus. And as weird as everything sounded, Kanye knew it wasn't going to hit with all audiences. Chicago's Young Chop, who himself was a pioneer in the Chicago drill music scene, was brought in by Kanye to give a youthful approach. Kanye's artistic goal was to always tap into his inner child. His consulting with younger artists got him closer to that youthful spirit. The childlikeness of Yeezus can be seen in its freeform process. And of course, there was Anthony Kilhofer, one of Kanye's closest producers, with their relationship dating all the way back to the College Dropout.
What up, Gear Sluts?
Love it.
Nope.
Back to the club. Last but not least, that came and helped like bring this whole shit together, that executive produced the album, me and the family, is Rick Rubin coming in and like finishing up the whole shit for us, which is legendary because everything that we did on this project, everything I did, like I was like, what will Rick Rubin do? What was this Def Jam shit, what they were doing? Because I remember like Rick even said, when we did Def Jam, we really wasn't feeling like we was in competition with nobody because this shit was so direct to where we at right now. We in the middle of the city right now, open to the motherfucking streets, and nobody shutting down shit while we making real music, y'all vibing out to this shit.
There were loads of great ideas, and there were many, many tracks. And we listened to everything together. We listened, he originally came over and said, hey, I want to come play you my new album. And I thought we were going to listen to a finished album. And then we listened to about 3 hours of music, most of which didn't have vocals. And at the end of it, it's like, wow, so what's it going to be? I'm thinking it's a year away. And he's like, well, you know, I'm putting it out in, I think it was like five or six weeks. Like, really? It's like, I said, you know, I have another album that's a lot further along than this, and it's not coming out for probably 5 months. And he's like, really? It's just a funny conversation, because it was completely normal to him.
Yeah.
It's just the way he works. Yeah. I think he's a great guy, super smart, and from a creative standpoint, I can't think of anyone who has come out, who has been more consistently great from the time they started making music until now. I can't think of anyone else. I think he's the most consistently great creative person in music today.
Aesthetically, the packaging of the CD itself was also a protest to commerciality, to an era of music that Kanye had considered dead. It was embracing the most naked aspects of minimalism while still saying something. In his own words, this clearly naked album casing would be the open casket of the CD. The casing was shown within the context of this scene from American Psycho, a film made during the height of the CD era.
You like Huey Lewis on the news?
They're okay.
Hey, do you like Kanye West?
He's okay, I guess.
What? The American Psycho influence would show itself later in the album as Kanye turns up the narcissism level on high as he speaks from the perspective of people giving in to their most base of desires.
Now your driver say that new Benz, you can't afford that. All that cocaine on the table, you can't snort that. That going to that, all that money that the court got.
He wanted there to be a sparseness in the album, some air for the sounds and the samples to breathe.
It seems like you're getting a little more minimalistic as time progresses. You're trying to do more with less. Do you see that as a trend, or was that just an aberration for Yeezus?
It's just kind of a trend for us. We're just learning. If you have something in your song that isn't turned up loud, you should just turn it off.
The spaces sort of speak for themselves.
Yeah, makes
what's
space,
missing,
yeah.
Right? So in the Kanye process, does he give you room in the collaboration?
Yeah, like everybody
brings everything to the party.
And just sees what sticks.
Blood on the Leaves proved that Kanye was still in love with soul samples, but it figured out a more naked, harrowing, and piercing way to incorporate them into the album. Nina Simone's performance of Blood on the Leaves is haunting.
I just need to clear my mind now. It's been racing since the summertime. Now I'm holding down the summer now.
I didn't look at him as nothing else but a genius. So anything that comes with being around a genius, I'm with it. I ain't that sensitive. All right, Kanye cussed me out for somebody else. Like, because the other person wasn't there for him to cuss out, he cussed me out. Yeah, get it. Yeah, come on, bro. Yeah, you got anything else you want to say? Okay, cool. You know what record we made after that? New Slaves. I need all your juices flowing. I ain't trying to impede nothing you do. I need your thoughts flowing freely.
The unveiling of New Slaves was a special moment in the early rollout for the album. Premiered through a phenomenal video, simply Kanye's face, rapping the verses while looking straight into the camera. It was shown across the globe in the United States, Europe, Canada, and Australia.
They weren't satisfied unless I picked the cotton myself. You see, it's broke nigga racism. That's that don't touch anything in the store. Excuse me, that's that can I help you, sir? That's that racial profiling out in front of Barney's and shit. Talking about did you steal that? And it's that rich nigga racism. That's that come in, Yank, please my mouth. We bring the fur coats. We bring the boats. Please, Bobo.
The song was performed on SNL, and it was followed by a new performance from another track called Black Skinhead. Projected behind Kanye was the three-headed dog Cerberus, which leads into the visual iconography featured throughout the album release and live tour. The darkness, the skulls, the symbols of death and division, along with a fiery live show bringing images of the end of the world, as Kanye, S. Devlin, and Vanessa Beecroft put on the most elaborate pop art pageant. Kanye had made his mood very, very clear to his audience. According to Vogue, luxury fashion house Mason Martin Margiela provided Kanye with several outfits for him to wear during his performances. Embroidered bomber jackets, blanket coats, and printed trousers were among the outfits given. Kanye worked closely with them on final designs, and he told them to make sure that their designs aligned with Vanessa Beecroft's vision. Margiela is known for their signature masks that usually appear in their runway shows, made of crystals and tiny mirrors. Kanye wore one of their crystal veils during a show in Paris, and they decided to work those elements into the Yeezus tour ensemble as well. This was showing that Yeezus was an experience that spanned across many mediums. Everything, from the audio to the visuals, were communicating his vision. In the words of Kanye's close creative collaborator, Elon Rutberg, the Yeezus tour narrative was a pure splicing together of Dante's Inferno and the story of King David in the Bible. Another highlight to the aesthetic of the album's release involved the daring typographical logos. They were clearly stealing from Metallica, but more as an aspirational homage, not as disrespect. But this was more than just a middle finger for the sake of being shocking. Kanye and his team were talking about liberation. Kanye was not only angered at what the industry's stereotypes and limitations meant as obstacles in his own career, but for others' careers also.
It's not about me, it's about you. I don't care if you like me, I care if you like yourself.
When I say Yeezus, what I mean is Yeez is us.
Because it's not that I could tell people, you know, what to buy or what not to buy, but I can make people believe in themselves so much that they don't care about an LV logo so much.
It's a new type of drug, high off life, high off confidence, high off self-esteem, high off believing that you can really live your motherfucking dream. That's that Yeezus.
Kanye had help with lyrics from many writers, but his closest writer is good music artist Sci-Hi the Prince, who started working with Kanye on Dark Fantasy. Sci-Hi has writing credits on over 30 Kanye tracks and is known for his excellent wordplay. But that didn't take Kanye away from getting comments from everyone else in the room.
What he pays me for, sometimes I don't think I should get paid for. Like a lot of people in the room, I don't think should get paid for some of the stuff they do, but Ye respects everything in the room. That's what makes him great. If you walk in with some white Valentinos and he, white Valentinos, Fanadinos. You'll have a check in the mail.
Really?
Yeah, his lawyers will be reaching out.
You know, I think that Kanye he's a master at putting people in rooms together that don't belong together. And so you're with the best of the best and everybody around you is like a master at whatever they do. He pushes everybody, and when he believes in you, he definitely gives you a piece of confidence that you've never felt before. He is much more open to people's ideas and opinions than you would think. Like, he plays music for everybody.
He said, I'm working on a new album, and if you want, I'll play it for you. And I was like, great. And he's like, I have a van out front. He went through an entire album, like 17 tracks, playing the beats on a laptop, and then rapping the song. Like this close to my face.
In between all of this are tons of anecdotes that go off into many tangents, but an interesting one, brought up by Noah Goldstein, involves Kanye's infamous croissants line, used in I Am a God.
Hurry up with my damn croissants!
Some people heard that line and immediately cringed, but Noah had a different take. He acknowledged that Kanye has always had a great gut instinct for which words would resonate the most with the crowds. Something as out of left field and confusing as
"Hurry up with my damn croissants!"
immediately makes it memorable. Whether you enjoyed hearing that or not, you won't forget it. And that is exactly what Kanye wants. Some will still call out Kanye for having co-writers by saying he is inauthentic. But every other genre employs co-writers without shame.
When you get to the Grammys and you see Adele walk on stage, and she has 30 people behind her, and they've all helped her work on this album. She's got album of the year. You think you're gonna beat her with just you and your engineer?
A new technique for Ye was recording his vocals solely to drum tracks before the additional melodies and instruments were added. Evidence of this technique is used in I'm In It.
Finna start a new movement, being led by the drums.
Kanye's inspiration for hard, clubby drums also took a page from Jaquan's Tipsy.
Two, here comes the three, to the four, to the five. Now I'm looking at Shorty right in the eyes.
time to take it too far now. Michael Douglas out the car now. Got the kids and the wife life.
The song is known to be one of his most vulgar, despite Justin Vernon emphasizing that Kanye does not really speak so sexually in everyday settings, and it is meant to be a visceral and exaggerated exposé on the theme of sex in much the same way that American Psycho has an exaggerated and disturbing commentary on excess and sexual violence against women. It is not necessarily an endorsement of the explicitness, as much as a mood to capture and make the listener uncomfortable through Kanye's darkly executed lyrics. But that is not to say that his lyrics go without criticism. Some do find it too vulgar or too simplified, and they might be right. But it seems that Kanye was going for mood over words in his songs. But no song would cause more controversy than the menacing I Am a God.
Mikasa, Sukasa, that's a Costa Nostra. I am a God.
Everyone went scrambling like God's lightning bolt was coming to roast Kanye right where he stood. But Kanye wanted to assure that the title was not blasphemous in nature.
If you say if it take us a year to do an album, I'll say 8 of those months I'll be just brainstorming, just being in the studio, just talking to each other. What do you think about this concept? What do you think about that? What if you say, what if I call myself a god? Would they be mad? Like, it's all that. We go back and forth. We bring in different religions, different, you know, thinkers from different places. And that's the main part of the album, just the brainstorming of it.
The core of the phrase is rooted and validated in the Old Testament scripture, Psalm chapter 82, verse 6. I said, you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. But lastly, it is also an album of rebirth and redemption. Kanye brings it all back with his emotional song, Bound 2, where he declares his love to his wife Kim, and willingly forsakes the women, the partying, and the fast life. Yeezus was a universally acclaimed project that wowed music artists across genres and served as a challenging inspiration for artists in general. The album was sticking a flag in the sand, or cracking the pavement, as Kanye would say.
I didn't come here to make bad people feel good. I came here to make dead people alive.
I like to just direct people to the light. I want to express that I feel the light and I have the energy and I feel extremely blessed. And I know that God within his time will provide me the opportunities to create more and more and more and make things more awesome.
Thanks guys for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe, and if you want to help me make more videos and to make them better, please donate to my Patreon page. You can donate as little as $1. There's cool perks, and for $5 you can get credited in each video that your money goes to. Thank you.